Today I'm here with the Secretary of Department of Drug and Alcohol Prevention.
Programs.
Yep. Secretary yep. Smith, and it's such a pleasure to meet with you.
Thank today. You. I'm honored to be here.
I just want to tell you how important this is to me, because I lost my brother at the young age of 39 to addiction.
Oh.
And back then, it was truly a stigma that we need to all learn to talk about. My parents had to lower him into the ground very quietly because of embarrassment,
shame,
all of that we need to do away with, you know. And in the last year and a half, I feel like this has been put on a back burner, you know, and it hasn't. I mean, our districts are overrun with, you know, deaths by opioids and other drugs. And just trying to get control of that is just so important. And your job is so important. And you have so many areas to look over that I do not envy you, Secretary Smith. So we're about to celebrate National Recovery Month in September. And tell us why it's celebrated.
So the important thing to remember about National Recovery Month is that it's really focused on hope. Mm-hmm. And by sharing stories of that hope, it really does help to reduce the stigma that you were talking about just a few moments ago. So the month is really all about individuals who have traveled that journey and their loved ones sharing their stories, sharing their challenges, but sharing the hopeful future that they've been able to witness through that journey to recovery. So there's always a theme every year for the National Recovery Month, and this year's theme is recovery is for everyone, every person, every family, every community. So I think the really important message this year is reminding folks that recovery isn't just about the individual with the substance use disorder, but it's about all the people who support them and wrap themselves around that individual to ensure their recovery journey continues.
Yeah. And I notice you have a calendar on your website that lists a ton of different events that are going on. Someone from my own county, Montgomery County, I think it was called the Lights, Star of Lights, on September 9th in Montgomery County. So there's an accessible calendar that people can go on to.
Absolutely.
And it's really filling up with different events.
It is,
so that is great. So so if someone wants to participate in Recovery Month,
great way to do it is to go to our website. So our website is ddap.pa.gov, and there's a great calendar of events. You don't need to register for most of them. You can just kind of show up and see what it's all about and spend some time there. Another way to participate in Recovery Month is by sharing your own story.
Yeah.
So individuals like you who have had a family member or individuals themselves in recovery, talk about it. Talk about what that journey has looked like and help to reduce the stigma and bring about those important conversations are all great ways to engage in Recovery Month activities.
Now, we've already talked about how COVID-19 has disturbed a lot of recovery efforts in the last year and a half. Can you talk about that at all and the effect that it's had?
Yes. So 2017 was when we saw the peak of overdose deaths in Pennsylvania, and that number hit almost 5,400 deaths. And following that year, we made some tremendous strides in addressing the issue and pushing some prevention and harm reduction and intervention. And we saw those deaths decline pretty drastically the following year. So we saw them about 18% decline in 2018, and they stayed relatively consistent in 2019. But then COVID hit us in 2020, and so those deaths are now around 5,200 individuals. So not quite where we were at the peak, but very, very close.
Yeah. So what kind of resources do you pull from? Is it mostly federal money? How's the state money coming in? Because what I've seen, it's not really enough from the state, but mostly coming from the feds. Is that correct?
Yeah, we get a lot of federal dollars.
Okay.
So we have a substance abuse block grant that is sort of our standard federal funding stream. But in addition to that, Congress over the last number of years has appropriated additional dollars to specifically address the opioid crisis and substance use disorder more broadly. Mm-hmm. So we have about three additional funding opportunities that have come in over the last couple of years to help us address the crisis. So that's really where we see the bulk of mm-hmm. those dollars. And what we receive from the federal government, a very large portion of that gets allocated directly to our counties, okay. where they do needs assessments and some strategic planning to ensure that every community's needs are addressed as unique needs.
Yeah. Now, have you seen which counties have suffered from this crisis more than others, even though I do believe we are seeing a lot of it in the rural areas as well?
Yeah, you know? Sure.
It's not just a big city problem.
It is not.
Problem.
It is not. Yeah, when you look at the overdose death rates, we see some high rates in rural counties. I will say, though, that still the large majority of overdose deaths are happening in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
That's not too surprising to any of us, but they usually account for nearly half of the overdose deaths in our state.
Yeah.
So still a tremendous issue there.
Yeah, I know we have a lot of recovery centers, and I wonder, was there a great effect? Like, were a lot of them not even being able to open because of COVID? Because
yes.
if you can't get in treatment versus, you know, just the place you check into, it's just not effective.
Yeah, most of our treatment providers remained open, but some of them had to reduce their capacity in order to implement distancing and, you know, sanitizing appropriately and those kinds of things.
Right.
So there was a bit of reduced capacity for treatment.
Yeah.
And then in terms of the recovery support centers, where individuals would go to maintain their recovery, mm-hmm. a lot of them had to transition to fully virtual platforms. Mm-hmm. And so that was a little tricky. It took yeah. some time to plan for that. And the reality is that not everybody appreciates the virtual platform.
Right.
Some of them really rely on that in-person connectivity to maintain their recovery. And so we definitely saw some recurrence of use of individuals in recovery as a result.
I'm sure people, you know, have to be one-on-one a lot of times to understand that they're not alone.
Yeah.
You know, you've done a great job with this department. I'm so proud of you.
Thank
and
you.
All the people you've been able to help. And I want to thank you for allowing me to participate with this today. And
well,
is there
absolutely.
Anything you want to close with?
I think the last thing I'd just like people to know, that there is a hotline available for anyone who's seeking help or even a loved one who just wants information.
Yeah.
That hotline is available 24/7, 365 days a year, and folks can access it by calling 1-800-662-HELP.